The battalion is filmed here marching to the brigade training camp in Karachi. In those turbulent days, India provided a tough training ground for soldiers. Frontier duty against hostile tribesmen on the northwest frontier, keeping the peace amidst the sectarian unrest in Karachi. Illness and disease a constant threat. India offered contrast, demanding and varied soldiering, but time for ceremony and sport. Here, on the parade ground of the Sindh Independent Brigade in Karachi, the battalion troops its colours during the annual proclamation parade on the 1st of January 1934. Colonel Birkett, commanding the 2nd Battalion, addresses the men while his wife, assisted by 2nd Lieutenant Bobby Loader in the dark blazer, presents the prizes at the end of the Cameron Run. This was a 4-mile cross-country championship held annually. In addition, cricket was keenly played in Karachi. The battalion held its own Goodwood races on the flats at Garryell, and there were shooting expeditions too. The regiment served in most of the main theatres of Allied operations. In the summer of 1939, the 2nd Battalion was in Belfast. Here, during an exercise, a 3-inch mortar is being set up. Soon, it would be mobilising for war. 5 battalions went to France in spring 1940. The 2nd, 4th and 5th formed a Royal Sussex Brigade, the 133rd Brigade, 44th Division. The 6th and 7th joined the 37th Brigade, 12th Division. German panzers, backed by air power, forced the BEF back to Dunkirk, the enemy swinging round and coming in from the west. Officers, 2nd Battalion, made in Newton, before leaving for France early April 1940. For them, it was a gallant campaign, ending at Haysbrook on 29 May. Many brave deeds were done, casualties sustained and prisoners lost, while others sought, as best they could, to join the evacuation through Dunkirk and elsewhere along the coast. One who remembers the scenes on the Dunkirk beaches is Major Matthew Lees. As a platoon commander with the brigade's anti-tank company, he had covered the battalion's withdrawal at Haysbrook. Few of his men were good swimmers, so rather than wade out to the small ships, they waited on the beaches till evening for the destroyer lift from the East Mole. The Mole stretched 1,400 yards out to sea. The queue took casualties. Getting aboard also presented dangers.
Because of the way the configuration of the Mole, the destroyers had been unable to pull in close against the structure, and there was a plank from the Mole to the destroyer, so it was something like 6 or 8 feet, which you had to cross to get onto the destroyer. And if you'd have gone over, that would have been it. I mean, no one could have done anything for you. And this was the sort of final terrifying part of the whole involvement to me.
The destroyer berthed at Dover, and here Matthew Lees and his men boarded a train en route to camp at Tidworth.
Well, we set off from Dover, and the first place we stopped was at Basingstoke, and there, as happened I think on quite a lot of the stations, good women from the Women's Voluntary Service, the WVS, handed us tea and bread and margarine through the carriage windows.
The day was 31 May 1940. There was soon an opportunity to telephone or telegram worried family waiting for news at home. For Matthew Lees, the ordeal of Dunkirk was over. For those taken prisoner in 1940, there would be long years of captivity in POW camps in Germany, Italy and occupied Europe. One was Lieutenant I.M. Austin, 5th Battalion, whose artwork includes this view of Offlag 7B at Eichstätt. General Sir Claude Auchinleck, Commander-in-Chief, Middle East Forces, inspects the 7th Indian Brigade, including the 1st Battalion Royal Sussex, at Mena Camp in March 1942. The battalion had joined the brigade near Cairo in October 1940, helping to overthrow the Italians in Eritrea and Abyssinia, and in November 1941, fighting with great distinction in the Battle of the Omars in Libya. Here, he takes the salute as two companies of the 1st Battalion marched past. Their gallantry and self-sacrifice at Sidi Omar was widely acclaimed. Thereafter, the brigade had pursued the retreating enemy, heroically facing the counter-offensive at Benghazi. During the inspection, General Auchinleck presented gallantry awards to the battalion and to the 411 Sikhs and 416th Punjabis. Again, rare footage of the 1st Battalion during Auchinleck's inspection. A month later, in April 1942, it would go to Cyprus for rest and training, returning to Egypt in September, ready for the Alamein campaign. It would remain with the brigade in the 4th Indian Division until the end of the war. After Dunkirk, the Royal Sussex Brigade was reformed and sent out to North Africa in May 1942. Here it was to come under the command of Brigadier Lashmer Gordon Whistler, pictured on the right, an outstanding leader of men, much admired by General Montgomery. He had served with the regiment in the Great War and had led the 4th Battalion since 1940. Under Whistler, the brigade fought off Rommel's attack on the Alam Halfa Ridge, so shifting the initiative to the Allies in readiness for Alamein. Here, a Royal Sussex patrol advances past the burning German tank after the battle. El Alamein is a small Egyptian township 50 miles west of Alexandria, its place in history assured as the site of one of the decisive battles of the Second World War. For both the 1st Battalion and the Royal Sussex Brigade, there were key roles to play. Alamein proved a triumph for General Montgomery's 8th Army over Field Marshal Rommel's Axis forces. His stirring eve of battle address, "Together we will hit the enemy for six right out of North Africa," is amongst the Whistler papers in the regimental archives. Montgomery's plan of attack was for a break-in through the minefields, followed by the piecemeal destruction of the enemy's infantry, and a breakout by the armour into the open desert. The Royal Sussex Brigade, now lorried infantry with the 10th Armoured Division, was to be prominent in a series of night attacks. Eve of battle, 23 October 1942. Officers of the 2nd Battalion gather as the Padre conducts prayers. The night brought a full moon and the opening barrage. The battle lasted 12 days. Night offences contributed to the victory. First on the Materia Ridge, then on Kidney Ridge, notably at strong points codenamed Snipe and Woodcock. But for the Royal Sussex Brigade, success at Alamein was not achieved without cost. One of those killed was 2nd Lieutenant Charles Colville Hare of the 5th Battalion. He died in the attack on Snipe on 27 October. Aged 20, he came from Burpham near Arundel. His letters home are in the archives. The 1st Battalion, having held the vital Ruisset Ridge in the middle of the Alamein line, now took part in the pursuit of the Germans to Tunisia. Here men of the regiment cheer as the King drives past with General Montgomery. To the front, nearest the car, is Lieutenant Colonel Jack Glennie, then only 28, who would lead the battalion in the final operations in North Africa and later in Italy. The 4th Indian Division moved to the 1st Army front for the Battle for Tunis. An attack at Medjez al-Bab broke the enemy's resistance, and on 7 May 1943, the city was entered to an enthusiastic reception from the local population. The 7th Indian Brigade, including the 1st Battalion Royal Sussex, was now sent up towards the foothills of Cape Bon, where a large portion of the German Africa Corps and considerable Italian forces had escaped. A battle ensued on the afternoon of 11 May, until the carriers and tanks gained the day. Then the white flags appeared and streams of prisoners began to come in. Here, German prisoners, seemingly happy enough with their lot, are seen driving in their own vehicle to a prison compound. On 12 May, thousands came down from the hills. The dope sheets accompanying these films note that the lines of prisoners stretch for 22 kilometres. Many look relieved and cheerful. Official figures quote 275,000 Germans and Italians surrendered at Cape Bon. It was the final defeat of the Axis powers in North Africa. For the 1st Battalion Royal Sussex, Cape Bon will be remembered for the part it played in the surrender in Awadi of General Jürgen von Arnim, Commander-in-Chief of the Axis forces in Tunisia. Von Arnim, en route to prison camp in Britain. He'd recognised Jack Glennie's cap badge. He'd fought against the regiment at Ypres in 1914. He was reminded that the Germans themselves had christened it the Iron Regiment. Von Arnim's staff car was used for some months by Colonel Glennie before being shipped to England. It was kept at the depot in Chichester, giving fun rides on Quebec days. A remarkable vehicle with 28 forward and 6 reverse gears, it is now on display at the Regimental Museum in Eastbourne. After its success in Tunisia, the 4th Indian Division trekked back through Egypt to Palestine before in December 1943 embarking from Suez for Taranto in southern Italy. Here at Cassino, the 1st Battalion would encounter bitter fighting. The Benedictine Monastery of Monte Cassino viewed from Allied positions. It was a key element in the Cassino defences, which blocked the entrance to the Liri Valley leading to Rome. The monastery towered above on a bare rocky promontory 1,700 feet high, with sides dropping down sharply into the plains beneath. It offered an excellent observation post for the Germans, from which they could direct their mortar and artillery fire onto any Allied movement in the valleys below. The campaign was a severe one. In 6 weeks, in the second and third battles for Cassino, in February-March 1944, 1st Battalion losses totaled 22 officers and 300 men. On the night of 12-13 February, the battalion moved up to a bare, razor-backed ridge called Snake's Head Ridge to relieve American units. Here, in the mountains behind the monastery, they would stay for 6 weeks. The terrain was rugged, the weather extreme. They were overlooked from three sides, sniped, mortared and shelled. John Buckridge, second left, was 20 at the time of Cassino, a platoon commander with C Company. His company commander was Major Ben Dalton, here smoking a cigarette. Interviewed for this video, he recalls his grim initiation to Snake's Head Ridge.
The shelters that we had were called sangars, and you couldn't dig. You had to build up sangars from the boulders and the rocks which were strewn all around. Now, the Americans had built up these little oblong shelters which were not more than 18 inches high, in which only two people could go. Now, this was normal. You had two men sangars, two men slit trenches. As dawn came, it was quite clear that these walls were not high enough to prevent the Germans from observing us. During the course of that morning, I'm afraid I was sitting with my batman in my sangar, and he was shot dead by a sniper from across the valley from a place called Phantom Ridge. He wasn't the first to be sniped and killed. So that was my initiation into this ghastly place called Snake's Head Ridge.
From the ridge, he had a good view of the bombing of the monastery on 15 February.
I could see hordes of flying fortresses in groups. And as I was watching, I suddenly saw, as they got over Cassino Town, the bomb doors open and watched bombs come down. Some of them hit the monastery, a lot of them didn't. And as the terrain was granite, exploding bombs caused granite splinters, and the casualties that we endured during that particular bombing came from granite splinters and not from any direct hit. We did not have a direct hit on any battalion or company or platoon position.
On the night of 15-16 February, C Company led an attack on Point 593, a key position on the ridge overlooking the monastery, a night recalled by John Buckridge.
As the day wore on, we received orders that we were to attack and take Point 593 with a view to the battalion passing through and trying to take the monastery. The monastery now being reduced to rubble and the Germans being in defensive positions. The C Company, consisting of 13, 14 and 15 platoon, got up from their sangars to attempt to wheedle the Germans off Point 593. But as we got close to within about 10 yards of the actual position, that is when the German machine guns, the Spandaus, opened up. And that is why I'm able to talk from personal experience about their line of fire, because you had it coming at you from about three or four different directions. And it was very, very uncomfortable.
the monastery at Monte Cassino in ruins. Another night attack was launched by the battalion to try to dislodge the Germans from Point 593, but again to no avail. The battalion was relieved at the end of March, and it was not until May, with the better weather, that Polish brigades succeeded in securing the ridge and Point 593 and taking the monastery. Here, Allied troops examined the strong points and observation posts the Germans had constructed in the monastery. The evidence of their use of the building lay scattered amidst the rubble and the relics of the ruins. The Allies were now free to advance up the Leary Valley. The 1st Battalion pushed northwards, engaging periodically in short, sharp attacks and continuing to take casualties. The monastery would be rebuilt, but for the Royal Sussex Regiment, Cassino will be remembered amongst its most hard-won battle honours. Amongst the wartime archives of the regiment are photographs of the Prime Minister, Winston Churchill, wearing the uniform of Honorary Colonel of the 5th Battalion, due to his office as Lord Warden of the Cinque-Ports. He had visited the battalion in the desert, but here the famous cap badge is prominent at the crossing of the River Rhine. After Alamein, the 10th Parachute Battalion was formed from volunteers from the 2nd Battalion. One was Captain Lionel Carrapel, whose courage and leadership at Arnhem in September 1944 resulted in a posthumous VC, the 6th and final VC awarded to the regiment. The regiment's last battle honours of the war were won in Burma by the 9th Battalion. It had been reformed in June 1940 by Colonel Gerald Templer, and after training in India, went into action from January 1944 to May 1945, first in the Arakan and then in North Burma. The battalion arrived at Michener in the middle of the monsoon season, giving the men an immediate baptism into the unique hardships of jungle warfare in unrelenting rain and mud. The objective was to push southwards towards Katha and Mandalay and to help drive the Japanese out of North Burma. The route lay through tall teak forests, swamps and swollen waterways. Mules carrying ammunition and equipment were constantly bogged down, needing manhandling to get them moving again. Often wading waist-deep in water, they pressed on, with the prospect at the end of a day's march of no dry sleeping area and no real rest. And when the monsoons finally lifted, though the footing was firmer, the heat by day became overpowering and many fell victim to heatstroke and exhaustion. Mosquitoes abounded. Malaria and jungle fever took their toll. Thick belts of jungle barred the way, the men hacking their way through with their cookeries, always vulnerable to attack by suicide snipers. The battalion was commanded by Colonel Oliver and was part of the 36th Division. Here in Burma, the division came under the command of the legendary American general Vinegar Joe Stilwell, the one British division fighting in the Northern Combat Area. The Burma Road extracted a heavy price from those who fought with the 36th Division in 1944-45. The 9th Battalion Royal Sussex engaged the enemy on a number of occasions. The Japanese fought fiercely, as at Hill 60 in August, sometimes fanatically, as at Pinwee in November, when the battalion beat off several attacks. On Boxing Day, the Irrawaddy was crossed, and finally in April, Mandalay was reached. The battalion would move on to India, then to Malaya, where it would provide the guard of honour for the Japanese surrender. A Company HQ, 9th Battalion at Katha, North Burma, Christmas Day 1944. Lest it should remain a forgotten army, the Pinwee Club ensured a permanent record of the battalion's deeds in Murray Gillin's book The Shiny Ninth, published in 1986. This has been a time of change and reorganisation in the British Army. In 1946, the Royal Sussex became part of the Home Counties Group, and in 1948 was reduced to one regular and one territorial battalion. Here at the depot in 1950, cadets learn how to handle anti-tank weapons under the watchful gaze of RSM Frank Greenfield. The first intake of National Service recruits reported to the depot on 7 June 1951. Every 6 weeks, a new intake of about 50 arrived for their initial 6 weeks training. They were joined by regular recruits arriving in larger numbers now as a result of the new arrangement of 3 years with the colours and 4 years on the reserve. This footage of the barracks in the 50s was taken by Major Philip Newton during his time in command of the depot. Modernisation came slowly to the barracks, and the old wooden buildings lingered on for some time. The Sandhurst block, for other ranks, had been built just before the Second World War, and new officers' quarters were built in the early 50s. But a large-scale programme of rebuilding would begin only after the closure of the depot in 1960, in readiness for the arrival of the Royal Military Police. One innovation, though, in March 1958, was the introduction of self-service meals in the dining hall in Sandhurst Block, remembered, no doubt, by many latter-day recruits. Meanwhile, the 1st Battalion, after service in Palestine and Egypt, had returned home in 1953. At Arundel Park in April 1954, it received new colours from Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth the Queen Mother. Here, she presents the colours accompanied by General Whistler, Colonel of the Regiment. On a fine morning, a crowd of 12,000 people watched as the colours were marched off, the ground being lined by 300 Sussex Home Guard and Territorials. The parade over, the royal guests departed, and in the afternoon, the regiment was presented with the honorary freedom of Arundel. The battalion, with band playing, colours flying and bayonets fixed, as was now their privilege, then paraded through the town, past the saluting base. There are those who remember today how hard it was marching down the cobbled hill in Arundel in hobnailed army boots. Accompanying them were contingents from the 4th, 5th, Cinque Ports Battalion and the depot, plus a large number of old comrades led by Major Peckett. A fortnight later, the battalion at Tidworth received a second royal visitor. To the delight of all, Her Majesty Queen Juliana of the Netherlands had been appointed Colonel-in-Chief of the regiment a year earlier, so renewing the link with the House of Orange, dating back to 1701. The regiment was not in the Korean War, but in 1956 the battalion was sent there as a Commonwealth contingent under the US Army before moving on to Gibraltar. At this time, a recruiting film was made by Lieutenant Paul Courtney.
Is your life just one dull day after another, in the same old job, in the same old place? Are you sure you are getting the best out of life? Maybe you would like to travel and see faraway places you've only dreamt about. Maybe you seek adventure. Something to lift you from your humdrum existence. Keen on sport, any sport you like. You go for ceremony and colour. And you want free food and lodging, plus £6 a week clear pocket money as a start, which can rise to over £20, as well as a month's paid holiday each year, join the Royal Sussex Regiment.
In March 1959, while based at Gibraltar, a pilgrimage was made to Cassino by four officers and 13 other ranks of the 1st Battalion, led by Major John Buckeridge. The Cassino War Memorial lists the names of 10 Royal Sussex officers and other ranks who died at Cassino in 1944 and have no known grave. Above, the monastery has been rebuilt in its original form. Filmed by Lieutenant Ewan Christian, the party walked down the lines of headstones in the war cemetery. Five officers and 59 other ranks from the regiment are buried here. Private John Sheridan, age 24. Private Cecil Marsh, age 29. The Unknown Soldier. After laying a wreath, Major Buckeridge led his party to Point 593, which 15 years before had claimed so many of those lives. It was a perfect spring day for the pilgrimage, so unlike that bitter winter of 1944. 1959 was also the 200th anniversary of the Battle of Quebec, and on its return from Gibraltar, the 1st Battalion began rehearsals for a reenactment at the Royal Tournament at Earl's Court in June, a colourful display, much praise for its ingenuity and imagination. Chichester folk had a chance to see the event for themselves later in the year when it was recreated for Quebec Day on the green at the regimental depot. Uniforms, even landing craft, were replicas of the originals, and every sequence of the battle, including the confrontation between the 35th Foot and the Royal Roussillon Regiment, was meticulously observed. A spectacular performance, climaxed by the death of General Wolfe, all of which thrilled the big crowd of spectators. The anniversary of the Battle of Quebec gave the regiment opportunity each year to open its gates to the people of its adopted home. Indeed, the barracks had been named Roussillon only a year earlier in 1958 to mark this link with the regiment. On this occasion, Sunday, 13 September 1959, the weather was perfect and Quebec Day attracted several thousand people to the depot. It was a real family day out, with Punch and Judy shows and Dotto trains for the very young, rides in Von Arnhem's car, and a whole range of sideshows and games. There was also a cricket match between the Territorials and Yeomanry, performances by the regimental band, and a pageant portraying regimental history. And of course, with a view to catching them young, an impressive array of military weaponry was on display to tempt potential recruits. The regimental journal described it as one of the most outstanding events ever held at the depot. Sadly, it would also be the last Quebec Day before the depot closed in 1960. The history of the barracks is told on a plaque, unveiled that day by Bernard, 16th Duke of Norfolk, who had himself served with the regiment in the 4th Battalion. It can still be seen at the barracks today. The depot closed on 31 March 1960. And the last recruit passing out parade was taken by the deputy colonel of the regiment, Brigadier John Ashworth, on 22 January. Appropriately, it was the Gaza intake, named in memory of his father, Colonel Hugh Ashworth, who was killed commanding the 4th Battalion at Gaza in 1917. Awards were presented to outstanding recruits and long